Ulster, and that could be really damaging.
Thank you. Stay with us. Tom Kelly, Peter Cardwell. We've got two former government special advisors, and we are welcoming now two members of the Conservative Party here in Northern Ireland, Felicity Huston and Irwin Armstrong. Good to have you both with us. Felicity, let's be clear, Felicity, every time I've ever interviewed you about Boris Johnson, you've never been a fan.
No, I think you can be quite sure, and nothing has changed. My opinion of Boris is no higher than it ever was.
Are you surprised by how this has all worked out?
Well, I think, you know, eventually, long runs the fox, but eventually it runs out of energy. And I mean, it is just an accumulation of stuff. And Boris's usual line and way of getting on hasn't worked this time. I think it's partly because people are so angry about the way we had to live last winter and this stuff going on. You know, I think that's it. You know, people will, as one of your previous commentators said, people, oh, it's Boris, you know. Well, no, this is way past, oh, that's Boris. You know, it really is. It's just heartbreaking to see what's gone on. I'd have him in the stocks, by the way.
You'd have him in the stocks.
Along with Cummings and one or two of the others who have shown their real general view of the rules and how little they apply or are important as far as they're concerned.
Irwin, are you sticking with him?
I think I am not. I'm certainly not going to jump on the political bandwagon without the facts. I don't know what happened. I mean, Tom said there was a party. I don't know if there was a party or not. How do you define a party? I honestly have no idea.
How do you define a party? You're in danger of getting into Bill Clinton territory here, aren't you? It depends what the meaning of is.
Yeah, no, but
we all know what a party is, don't we, Irwin?
No, we don't.
They had drinks, they had party games, there was a secret Santa, we're told, they stayed until after midnight.
Yeah.
Come on, it's a party, isn't it?
There's a scene in The Simpsons,
But is it a party? Does it meet the definition of a party, Irwin?
Where is the proof? Where is the evidence of what happened? We are all guessing on the innuendo and the media, it's everything. I prefer to wait for the report that comes out and said, here's exactly what happened. If there was a party, of course there shouldn't have been a party. Allegra should not have been trying to be humorous in the middle of a pandemic. So a lot of things shouldn't have happened, but I much prefer to wait and see exactly what did happen before I start saying off with their heads. I mean, this is very much a knee-jerk reaction, largely, to be fair, led by the media. They're the people who've been pushing it. Now, it may be right, it may be wrong, but all of these people who are out there saying this is what happened, they don't know. They're reading the media, they're listening to chit-chat here and there. That is what is really doing, and I object.
Well, I mean, hang on a minute. Hang on a minute. If this actually happened, if they did have a Downing Street party, Irwin, against the regulations that they expected the rest of the country to follow, while people couldn't even say goodbye to their loved ones who were dying. Would you consider that an important story?
Yeah, if it happened.
Because that's what the media is questioning.
Yeah, if it happened, that's exactly the situation. It shouldn't have happened then, I'm quite clear on that. But I am not going to have a knee-jerk reaction and assume because I read it in the media that it did happen. I don't know. It definitely should not have happened anywhere if it did. And that is very straightforward.
All right, let's take the situation where Simon Case, the Cabinet Secretary, let's say he finds that there were parties at Downing Street, Christmas parties, and they were in breach of the regulations. What should happen then, Irwin?
Well, number one, head should roll. I'm very much of the opinion that the Keenan in 10 Downing Street need to learn, apart from parties, which I'm not going to decide upon until I hear what the report says, but they need to learn a bit of humility and understand the country a little bit better. I think the messaging of late has been very poor.
Do you think Boris Johnson should resign if that's the outcome of the investigation?
I think if the investigation finds out that there were parties organised by his senior team, then he's a leader. He's in trouble.
He should resign.
If he misled the House, he's in serious trouble. I'm not so much into the electoral side of things, because that's very much within the Conservative Party, and what happens in 3 or 4 years' time is a very different issue.
All right.
You know, I am not in favour of the direction the Conservative Party has been going in anyway. They are not controlling the agenda. They have done a reasonably good job of the whole vaccination program, et cetera.
Sure.
So there have been successes in among the failures.
Yeah.
But, you know, this idea of, you know, you decide what happens when you don't know what happened, to me, that's a ridiculous thing, and that just goes against fairness. And the Allegra Stratton thing, she made a serious mistake.
But the Prime Minister told us there was no party ahead of any investigation.
That's what he believes.
Well, no, you're saying you shouldn't do that. That's exactly what he did. He came to a conclusion before any investigation.
No, he's inside number 10. He should know if it's found out that there was a party.
Well, he tells us he doesn't know there was a party.
Sorry?
He says he's been given... I mean, am I right on this, Peter, that Boris Johnson's position is he has been told by advisors that there was no breach, and he takes it on their word, simply that? Peter, does that summarise it?
Yes, that's correct. That's what he's saying, and he's saying I was informed by senior people. The other question I would ask Irwin is, if there was no party, why has Allegra Stratton resigned?
Oh, because she tried to make humorous remarks. She didn't say there was
a party.
That
didn't happen. About something.
Yeah, about she wasn't there.
You honestly believe?
Do you think that's the basis for a resignation? Making humorous remarks?
I think making humorous remarks in the middle of a pandemic about an issue when other people were staying at home and doing things, making that sort of lighthearted remarks and having the rest of the people in the room.
But she made her remarks, Irwin. She made her remarks specifically about a party which happened. I mean,
The words she used, she said she didn't know, but it was socially distanced or something. There was no, or wasn't socially distanced.
Yeah.
It was not a clear message that there was.
Irwin, did you see the video of Jacob Rees-Mogg making jokes in the middle of a pandemic about Christmas parties at the Institute of Economic Affairs and joking about the fact that they were socially distanced by 2 inches? Is that a resignation matter?
Yeah, I think anybody who goes against the rules has a serious issue. It's a bit like Northern Ireland.
Do you think Jacob Rees-Mogg should resign?
Yeah, well, Jacob Rees-Mogg should not have said what he said.
Do you think he should resign?
I think he shouldn't hold a position within government anyway, but that's another story.
Oh, right, you're not a fan of him. All right.
I am certainly not a fan of Jacob Rees-Mogg.
You have to be careful when you're talking to Tories to find out which teams they're on. Let's go to Liam.
Well, I'm not on any team.
I know. Everybody's got their fans and their favourites. Here's Liam. Hi, Liam.
Hello, William. Did Billy Connolly get Boris right when he said anybody who would listen to Boris needs professional help? And as far as Boris's credibility is concerned, early on in the virus, Boris got the virus. Was he flaunting the rules, or were the rules not working? His father flaunted the rules. And in relation to people, the subject you mentioned there about people seeing relatives in hospital, that was an indictment of the government and health, that they didn't allow one member of a family to be suited in PPE, and you see their dying relatives. Now, that was an indictment of government and health, a serious indictment.
Liam, thank you very much. A couple of questions here, Tom Kelly, about the role of the Cabinet Secretary. Now, the Cabinet Secretary is the senior civil servant, head of the civil service, is not a political appointee. Let's be clear about that. But do you have confidence that the internal investigation system, Tom, can be trusted to give us the answers to these questions we need answered?
Well, I think Simon Case is in the most difficult position of anybody regarding this, because on the one hand, he needs to be able to show that he is independent and objective about this. On the other hand, he has to support the Prime Minister, and therefore he is facing two completely different directions. Now, I think they've just clarified that he wasn't at any of the gatherings that are to be investigated.
That's encouraging.
That helps him. But I think if this comes out and it looks in any way like a whitewash, his credibility as head of the civil service will be in tatters. So I think he is under severe pressure.
And he hasn't been in the job very long either.
And he also, you know, let's put it kindly, whenever he was appointed, there was an element of surprise rather than him being seen to be the natural choice. So I think his position will be under a lot of scrutiny.
Well, he's very young, isn't he, to be Cabinet Secretary? He's very young. And he's only been a permanent secretary for a few months before he got this job.
Yeah, and I think this all goes back to, and part of your conversation with Irwin, this all goes back to not having done what they should have done a year ago, mm-hmm. which was whenever you spot there's a problem, and however you define it, this gathering, stroke party, whatever, was clearly a problem, and that was what the pretend press conference was about. Whenever you spot there's a problem, you get the facts and you nail it down.
Yeah.
And that's what people never saw about my job in number 10. A large part of my job in number 10 was not actually speaking to the media, though I did that twice a day. The larger part of my job was to say, here is a potential problem.
Yeah.
Let's tie down the facts and be ready for when the story breaks.
Yes.
They weren't ready a year ago. They weren't ready last week. Still not ready.
Irwin Armstrong is not. I'm just going to put a question to Felicity. Yeah. But Irwin Armstrong is not convinced yet. The evidence is not clear that there were, in fact, parties, right? So, Felicity, the Cabinet Secretary is investigating three parties, one on the 27th of November, one on the 18th of December, and one on the 10th of December.
William, you shouldn't call them parties until there's...
That's what Downing Street's calling them.
Oh, no, soirees. I think we'll call them soirees. Well,
they're calling them
the
parties
rules
in their statement, Irwin.
Then they're crazy. They're totally
the question is whether the parties comply with the COVID rules, Felicity.
Well, one man's party is obviously, as say, another man's soiree, or what did Allegra say, a wine and cheese. This is ridiculous. I think we all know what we're talking about. And, you know, Tom was saying they should have got their facts straight. No, they shouldn't have done it. If they believe we're in this pandemic and it's so dangerous and we can't mix for fear of all catching COVID and giving it to our grannies, then what were they doing? Not partying, or whatever we want to call it. And I think fundamentally it's that instead of trying to say, oh, well, and come up with these ridiculous definitions, there is a real question about the genuine beliefs of those people about what's going on and how they're running our country. And I mean, we now have a dead cat, as I gather the terminology is, for what the PM did yesterday. I gather, was it Lytton Crosby who came up with this one, that you, when you're in a chaotic situation, I'm sure Tom's well aware of it, you produce a dead cat on the table, which distracts. Yeah. And now that's why England has got the starting of Plan B. Here's a dead cat, so nobody will say, what on earth were you doing? How could you do such a thing?
You don't think that was planned in advance because of Omicron?
No, I don't, because I don't think... Well, so many people have said no, including like the Cabinet didn't even get a say in it. They were told on, was it Tuesday afternoon?
Well, if that's true, that would be outrageous, that you're introducing public health restrictions to distract from a PR problem.
Well, that's certainly a strongly held belief, and I'd be curious what Paul thinks.
Or having a daughter at the same time.
Well, I don't think you could describe that as a dead cat. I mean,
that's the point I was making.
That's just obstetrics.
Exactly.
You know?
You can't actually choose when a baby...
Let's not hold it against the child,
well, you
please.
You can, but it's complicated.
Yeah.
Yes.
I guess, Peter, there are those who think, you know, with Boris Johnson, the chaos is priced in. This may be a bubble story. I know you've mentioned Ant and Dec, but who else cares? Where is this traction? We're heading to the weekend. We'll come back on Monday. And we'll all go back to normal.
Believe me, this is not a bubble story. This is, you know, Warren Buffett, the financier, said it takes 20 years to build a reputation and 5 minutes to lose it. And I think that we're in a situation where a lot of the moral authority is gone as a result of this. And in fact, is actually a really important point that Tom Kelly made as well. That is cut through. It was two nights in a row on I'm a Celebrity, Get Me Out of Here that was mentioned. There are jokes about this. There are memes about this. This is something that's going to be remembered. I actually think it's Barnard Castle 2.0 in the sense that people remember Dominic Cummings and what he was doing. And just on the birth of Boris and Carrie Johnson's second baby, I think we can all celebrate and be happy about that. But I think I can probably say fairly fair certainty that there would be a party at number 10 to celebrate the fact.
Okay. Adrian. Hi, Adrian.
Hi, William.
How do you feel about all of this, Adrian?
Oh, it's the best news ever, because
which
I'm
bit?
Actually quite glad that there's parties taking place.
Oh, you're glad they've been having parties?
Oh, yeah, because it just blows apart all the credibility of these restrictions. And it reminds me a lot of the whole incident with Gordon Brown. Do you remember when he was caught on there making remarks like a lady called Gillian Duffy? And nobody ever took the Labour Party seriously when it came to immigration ever again. And I sense a similar thing is happening with regards to Boris Johnson.
Yeah, that was the hot mic situation in the back of the car, wasn't it, with Gillian Duffy during the election campaign? Yeah.
Yes, that's right. And, yeah, I mean, it just proves what many of us have thought all along, that they're not taking it seriously in the sense that they impose restrictions upon the rest of us, but they do a different thing. It's just simply one route for them and another route for everybody else. And, yeah, I mean, I don't see him lasting until the next election. He'll be gone before then.
It's a few years to go before that next election. Thank you, Adrian. Will he be gone much before then, though, Peter?
I think it just depends on a lot of things. I think, as Tom Kelly says, it depends on the North Shropshire by-election, which is next week, even if it's a very bad result. I think it depends on the local elections in England in May as well. It depends how things go. It depends how whether Christmas involves some sort of respite and whether we can get back to some sort of normality as well, and especially with the restrictions, whether there can be a sense that actually there is an acceptable level of risk with COVID, that, of course, there will always be variants. COVID will be with us in the way the flu is with us, although obviously it's much more serious in some regards. So I think if there can be some sense of normality, some sense of steadying the ship, I think Boris Johnson can continue, but I think there'll be a lot of people gunning for him. And, of course, Keir Starmer landed a number of blows yesterday at Prime Minister's questions. And in a sense, it doesn't even take Keir Starmer, because Boris Johnson's biggest opponent at the moment is probably himself.
Felicity Huston, how long do you give him?
I
don't mean how long would you give him?
No.
You give him about 10 minutes. But how long do you think, realistically?
Yes, quite. It's interesting. I was just thinking, you know, people were saying, you know, a while off, but look how quickly Margaret Thatcher was got rid of. I mean, who would have thought it? You know, never forget, she won the first round. Well, it was the first round of the year.
Yes.
And the ballot, and they got rid of her within some
When they
four
turn,
days.
They turn.
When they turn, they don't. I think one of the things, if nothing...
The cabinet's with them, though, aren't they? The backbenchers may be upset.
The backbenchers aren't. I don't know how many of the cabinet... And, you know, I wish some of them would grow a spine. I mean, they're supposed to be there to lead. He's first among equals. He's not a dictatorship. And yet, where are the ones that we're told oppose what he wants to do or how he's getting on? They won't come out of one of them, which is very disappointing. But I think, if nothing too exciting comes out over the weekend, and who knows what the papers have in store, I think it then will depend on how they do in North Shropshire. And I mean, certainly the polling was suggesting it wasn't going well before this because of the reasons why the Shropshire by-election has been called. So if they get a real bloody nose there, I mean, Owen had to shovel the votes in, didn't he? Got so many, such a big majority. If that goes, I think that might really start to get worried.
One per by-election wouldn't finish.
But
it
would if it meant that, on top of everything else, one by-election is neither here nor there. There are a lot of people sitting on tiny majorities, you know.
Yeah.
All those guys who never expected to
of
be
course.
MPs.
Yeah.
And they are sitting there thinking, we're going down again, you know, if he keeps this up. So I think that's the sort of thing that might produce a bit of soul searching, a bit of analysis, and a bit of, well, then the big long dagger comes out, as only the Conservative Party can wield.
Irwin, I'm so sorry, but I'm getting more text messages about you than Boris Johnson at the minute. Of just people astonished at your willingness to give him the benefit of the doubt.
I'm not giving anybody the benefit of the doubt. I'm waiting for the facts to be apparent. Nobody else seems to want to wait for the facts to be apparent. And I think, you know, the one thing when you talk about, will Boris, how long will he be there for? I think one of the big problems for the Conservative MPs is there is no heir apparent there. There is nobody that they're going to look at and say, oh, he's better than Boris or worse than, you know, better, or can do better. You know,
well, what's wrong with Rishi Sunak?
He's only been in the politics for a short period of time.
Yeah, but every time he comes out in public, he's giving money away. People like him.
Well, giving money away is not necessarily the reason why I would want to see him elected as our new Prime Minister. I think we are getting the country more and more into debt. I think total now, when you add everything in, it's about $3 trillion, which is frightening. You know, if you divide that by the number of people in the UK, we are all very seriously in debt, and we need to think about how we get out of that debt, not how we increase it, which he seems to be doing at the moment. I am willing to give anybody the benefit of the doubt when I don't know the facts. Once I know the facts, then I will come up with a finite answer that says yes. And I think I said, look, if Christmas parties took place, then he has a very serious problem. If it was in the building that he actually, I think, lives next door to now, upstairs, I think not knowing what's going on in your own house is a very serious problem for anybody.
Peter Cardwell, just finally, I mean, you can just imagine writing the lines, couldn't you, for a minister going out for an interview. And the lines would be something like, there was not a party, but if there was a party, it wasn't in breach of the rules. And if it was in breach of the rules were unclear.
Yes, I mean, I think it's very, very difficult. Sajid Javid, of course, was on the media round this morning talking to the media. He said he had no clear idea why Allegra Stratton resigned as a spokeswoman. It's very difficult. I think as well, politically, you know, Boris Johnson sent out a number of ministers to defend this. Dominic Raab was out earlier this week, Oliver Dowden, the chairman of the Conservative Party, and they will be annoyed as well, given what has emerged here. So
they're all taking one for the team.
The Prime Minister needs to get his house in order pretty soon.
Thank you all very much. Wonderful panel. Tom Kelly, Peter Cardwell, Claire Hanna, Felicity Huston, Irwin Armstrong, lots of you texting as well. Gareth says, Downing Street is like a Richard Curtis movie at the moment, but maybe not with such a happy ending. Boris would do well to show some humility, admit his flaws, maybe be an unlikely hero like Hugh Grant in Love Actually. But fairy tales seldom happen in real life, Frank. Is it four weddings and a funeral, Love Actually, or four children and an election, says Gareth.